Well, good morning, and let me welcome you to another day here at First United Methodist Church. God has been really good to us and blessed us with a great day, great weather. I know it's been miserably hot, but hopefully this week we'll get back to somewhat normal where we can at least get outside and do some things. You know, I don't know how much we'll be able to do, but more than we have been. One of the things I wanted to mention first is we have kids going back to school very soon. And so we are taking up collections for hygiene kits, which we'll be giving out to the different youth in our community to have, which will include, you know, deodorant, shampoo, soap, lotions, things like that. And we're going to continue to take collections for that throughout the year, as we realize that as much of a blessing as those hygiene kits are, they just don't last all that long. And so we'd like to be able to make that something that's available year-round if possible, and we'd love to be able to do that. And just to let people know that God's looking out for them, and that's what one way that we can go ahead and help this community, so to speak. Another thing that I wanted to mention is we're still collecting water for different events that we have going on, and we like to have that available for anything that we do outside, anything that we need to go to and attend. So we like to have that water available. So if you want to, you can just donate a case of water or again, just, you know, make a donation and mark on it, you know, water donation. One other thing that I wanted to lift up to you is we had planned to do a United Sunday on the fifth Sunday of this month. Not every month has five Sundays, and so whenever we do, we like to do something special. And so the idea was for us to all come together as one service and worship together and be able to be a family. However, plans change, and things have happened in our community and in our world that we feel like right now it is not the best time for all of us to come together and to be around one another in a smaller space. So we feel like we're going to go back to doing our regular services and spread out people so that we're not in close contact. Basically, it's because of the COVID virus, which still continues to just plague our community and plague our world. And so we want to make sure that we lift up everyone who is being affected by this, everyone who has COVID, everyone who has family members who have COVID. I especially want to say thank you. Thank you so much to all the doctors, the nurses, all the healthcare people that are putting in so many extra hours and taking care of people. Just know that I appreciate you, and we appreciate you, and we love you, and we thank you. This is something that I wanted to also mention is that while we all have our own choices to make, in my opinion, and this is my opinion, and I want to say that, is that I want to encourage people to get vaccinated if you feel led. I'm not one of those people that's going to shame you if you don't want to, and I'm not going to, if you have a different opinion than mine, we're still going to be friends, and I'm still going to support you. But it is my opinion that the vaccine is something that will help people, and it will definitely save lives. In talking to a lot of the people that have been a part of this, you know, as far as professional scientists, physicians, most of them have been, pretty much all of them have been in total support of this vaccine. And I'm one of those people that I believe that God does heal, God does provide safety and comfort, but I also believe that God gives talents to people such as the scientists and the researchers that have gone on to develop these vaccines and these physicians that are treating people. And so I feel like God works through them as well. And so it's not one of those things where, you know, you're putting fear over faith or faith over fear. It's more for me is like, I'm just putting my faith in God and trusting him that he has control. He has things in his hands, and I'm trusting that he knows what he's doing, and we have to continue to fight this good fight. But however you feel and wherever you feel led, at least let's just all join together in prayer and lift up our world that's going through such a difficult time. We need to put aside all of our squabbles, put aside any political differences, put aside any kind of agendas, and just be one and be there for one another and treat people right. And that's what I think Jesus calls us to do, is just to love one another. And that's what I think this is the time to do. And so please continue to lift up in prayer the people that are being affected and the people that are there to treat it. And I just give all thanks, honor, and glory to God for just being a part of all this and showing us throughout everything that He is still good and He is still in control. So thank you for being a part of this. You're going to really enjoy our worship service today. We continue to go through the book of Exodus, and our friend Jim Carrier is going to be our preacher today, and he's going to talk a lot about Moses and the call that God put on his heart. And so look forward to hearing from that, and look forward to seeing you whenever we can see you in person. And it's great to know that you all are out there, and just know that God is here and God is working. We thank you, and until next time, God bless.
Well, good morning. Let me welcome you to First United Methodist Church today. My name is Ryan Davis. Let me say that summer is starting to wind down, but it doesn't mean that it hasn't hit us hard these last few weeks, especially these big guys like me. I'm ready for the colder weather, I tell you. A couple things I wanted to lift up to you. The first thing is that we are going to try to provide hygiene kits for different youth in our schools this year that would need it. This would include shampoo, conditioner, lotions, soaps, things of that nature. And we're looking for donations to be able to purchase those to give out to those in need, if you would like to give towards that. And one thing that I would like to do is to try to give to this year round, as these hygiene kits are a true blessing, but they do run out quickly. And so there's going to be a need for them, I think, going forward. And so if we would, I would like to be able to give towards this year round. And so I think that's a great idea and a great opportunity for us to give to our community and to bless others. Also, later this month, we were going to try to have our fifth Sunday as a Unity Sunday, where we would all come together and worship as one in one service. But with everything that's going on in the world with COVID and the new Delta variant and things as bad as they are, we just feel like this was probably the wrong time to bring a lot of people together. And so we're going to postpone that and continue to just go on with the services the way they are, spread out over three different times. And so I wanted to make sure you all were aware of that and didn't show up expecting that or at the wrong time on that Sunday. And if you know anyone who was expecting to do that, please let them know that that's the case going forward. But we'll definitely reschedule that for a later time. Right now, I would ask that each of you would just please stand. And in your bulletin, we have the call to worship, and I'm going to lead you together in that. Break forth into joy. Sing together, for the Lord has comforted his people.
Therefore, the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come with singing to Zion.
They shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and mourning shall flee away.
He has put his words in our mouth and caused us to shine on the nations. Amen. Please remain standing. Our morning hymn of praise is hymn number 454. The Bible says, where two or more are gathered, there I shall be. So the Lord is with us. And the opening phrase to our opening hymn is, open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. God has a word for you today. Let's all sing all three verses of open my eyes that I may see.
Place in my hands the wonder.
please remain standing for the affirmation of faith found on page 881 in your hymnal.
Please join with me in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us now bow our heads for the morning prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this day. Thanks for all the goodness that flows from you through your Son, Jesus Christ. May we experience his goodness every day. May we lift up our hearts to you and just know that you have our needs and our best interests at heart. God, for all of us today, let the problems of our world fall away for just this time so that we could focus solely upon you. And God, we just lift up so many in this world who are suffering and going through difficult times. For those that are sick, we ask for healing. For those that are mourning, we ask for strength. And for those that are just going through difficult times, God, we just ask that you would just carry them through. Today we also pray the same prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Be still, my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide. and wind still know His voice who ruled them while He dwelt below. Be still, my soul, the hour is hastening on, when we shall be and tears are past, all safe and blessed we shall meet at last. All safe and blessed we shall meet at last.
I will say that we sure have some great musical talent in this church, do we not? And bless God. Thank you. The scripture reading today comes from the book of Exodus, chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, and then verses 11 through 12. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Well, welcome to week two of our new series entitled Breaking Bonds. Last week, David kicked it off talking about the midwives in Exodus 1, how they had a calling to heal, but Pharaoh asked them to go against their calling and to kill instead. At that time, Israel lived in Goshen, and they had need for nothing. God made sure everything was provided for them. But Pharaoh lived in Egypt and in a culture of more, and we live in that same culture today. We live in a culture that gossips and backbites and lusts after immoral things and always, always wants more. We live in a culture of busy and hurry. And he called us last week to break those bonds and say no to that culture and all that that culture has to offer. This week we look at Exodus 3. And to some, a very familiar passage. Over a century ago, a British doctor and explorer traveled to Africa for medical missions. On June 26, 1866, as he was traveling, he came across a well-adorned African woman. She was wearing beads, which, for those around at that point, signified that she had wealth. And as she was traveling, she was with a very unfamiliar, strange man. Now, this woman had a staff jutting out of her back, known as a slave stick. These slave sticks were used to steer a person in the direction one would want them to go. When she saw the doctor, she cried out about the injustice being done to her. He realized the man was probably a slave trader. He later wrote that he had been in that place at that exact moment to cross paths with these two individuals. He knew that this was a divine appointment. He asked the woman what was being done to her. She told the British doctor that she was a close relative of a nearby chief, and she was en route to see her husband when this man chased her maid off and captured her. The man, eager to continue moving, said that the woman had fled from this chief and that he captured her in order to take her back to him. The doctor, having a feeling that this man was about to sell this woman into slavery, asked the man what he expected in return from the chief. "Nothing," said the man. The doctor knew this was a lie. He gave the man a gift of fine woven cloth to give to the chief in compensation for freeing this woman who ran away. He then freed the woman and took her to her husband. God had prepared this doctor for such a time as this. The doctor would go on to write about the horrors of slavery and why it must stop. The doctor, Dr. David Livingston, would go on to travel and win souls and travel and be the first man to travel across the southern part of Africa. God had prepared David Livingston to go to Africa to do medical missions, which would in turn be a greater mission, one of fighting slavery in Africa. If it weren't for Dr. Livingston, this woman and many others would have been taken from their families and sold into slavery. Centuries before Dr. David Livingston, another man received a calling. And we find this man in the same boat as Dr. David Livingston, a call that he thought was too much to bear. This was no British doctor. He was a shepherd on the backside of the desert. But this was no ordinary shepherd. This shepherd grew up in Egypt, attending the finest schools and receiving the best training that Egypt had to offer. And in Genesis 3, we find this shepherd, Moses, tending the sheep of his father-in-law, Jethro. Verse 1 says that now Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian, as he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. So here we see the angel of the Lord, the pre-incarnate Christ, show up on the backside of the desert. Now, why in the world would the pre-incarnate Messiah show up on the backside of the desert in the middle of nowhere? He obviously had some sort of reason for being there. And just as Dr. David Livingston, Jesus shows up to meet Moses in a divine appointment in the most unlikely of places to give Moses a message at just the right time. So why was this just the right time to give a message to Moses on the backside of the desert? Let's go back and see how Moses, the one-time son of Pharaoh's daughter, went from the decadence of Egypt to the desolation of the desert. After being raised by one mother, his adopted Egyptian mother, in the most extravagant palaces of Egypt and being educated by the greatest teachers of the day, Moses was still partially raised by his birth mother, who nursed him as a baby and no doubt taught him about his Hebrew heritage. One day Moses went out with his kinsmen and saw an Egyptian beating an Israelite. Moses looked around, didn't see anyone, and so he killed the Egyptian and then buried him in the sand. No one knew, right? No one saw, so no one should know. The next day, Moses was out among his people again, and he sees two Hebrew men fighting each other. And so he goes to break up the fight, and he starts questioning them. And one of them responded, "Who made you ruler over us? Are you going to kill me like you did the Egyptian?" Moses got scared. Moses knew that his secret was out and that eventually Pharaoh would find out. And if Pharaoh found out, Pharaoh was going to kill Moses. Well, eventually, Pharaoh did find out. And when Pharaoh called Moses to him, he had already left Egypt. Like, Moses put some distance between himself and Pharaoh, like 360 miles worth of distance. So let's do some math here. Let's say Moses could average 20 miles a day, okay? That's a lot, but let's just say he can. Then he would have to travel 20 miles a day for 18 straight days to get to where he was. Moses wasn't going to stop until he couldn't see, hear, or think of anything from Egypt at all. So this was over 2 weeks of running from trouble. Many of us run away in fear when faced with our past sins and mistakes. We like to say, I'm going to stand there and take it like a man. Whatever I've got to take, I'll take. But every one of us runs from something. Moses may or may not have been done running, but when he came to a watering place, to a well, and he came across seven women being run off by shepherds, he decided to step in. Now, reminder, this is exactly what got him in trouble in the first place. But this time he learned his lesson. This time he didn't go kill anybody. Instead, he draws water for the women, takes it to them to water their flock, and makes sure the shepherds don't come back around to harm them. So in turn, the ladies go back and they tell their dad, Jethro, the priest of Midian, just how heroic Moses had been. So Jethro asks Moses to stay for dinner. And then he asks Moses to join the family by offering Zipporah, his daughter, to Moses for a wife. Now, Moses had no family. Egypt was where his family was, and he wasn't about to go back to Egypt. So Moses takes Zipporah's hand in marriage, and eventually they have kids. And as time goes by, Moses the protector begins tending his father-in-law's sheep. For 40 years, Moses would tend the flock of Jethro, whose real name was Reuel. If you read further on down, people have asked before, well, why do they call him Jethro? Why do they call him Reuel? His real name is Reuel. So in these 40 years, all he did was tend the flock? Like, all he did was watch over sheep? What are the things that went on in these 40 years that we don't read about? Well, this period of untold 40 years was God's transformation of Moses from prideful, impulsive murderer to humble, meek leader. Moses would change from being the shepherd of Reuel's flock to being the shepherd of Yahweh's flock. It's possible that 40 years prior, if Moses was offered this, if Moses was told that God wanted to use him, that he either would not have taken it on, or if he had, he wouldn't have reacted appropriately. So it took 40 years to prepare Moses for the biggest role of his life. Some of us go through our own 40-year prep time. I know I did. I know that it wasn't 40 years, but with the ups and downs, it sure kind of felt like it. But it led me to be who I am now, someone who's tired of running. As Moses is out in the desert, he sees a bush burning. But was it really burning? Verse 3 says, then Moses said, I will turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. Then he said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Yahweh addresses Moses and tells him he's standing on holy ground. Now, did Moses know who he was talking to? I mean, Moses had been in Midian for 4 decades. He hadn't been around other Jewish believers to continue hearing stories and to learn about God. He lived in modern-day Saudi Arabia. So surely he hadn't heard or learned about God in that place, had he? Remember who Moses' father-in-law is. Jethro, the priest of Midian. In preparation for the sermon, I kept reading through this text, and I kept seeing priest of Midian. And I thought, what kind of priest was Jethro? Like, who did he worship? And my question took me back to Abraham, the father of the nation of Israel, who had just lost his wife Sarah and mother of Isaac. Genesis 25:1 says, Abraham again took a wife, and her name was Keturah. And Keturah, his new wife, bore Abraham 6 children, one of whom was Midian. It is believed that Jethro, meaning excellence or posterity, was a title. And that title meant high priest of Yahweh. So Moses, while running from fear, was put in the direct path of his future wife and daughter of the high priest of God, who no doubt would teach Moses the history and relationship between their forefather Abraham and the Lord their God. Don't miss this. Even in his sin, God loved and led Moses to the place that was best for him. Even in his sin, he just murdered a man. And even in his running, God directs him right where he needs him to be. Oftentimes, God puts us in a direct pathway of another, a divine appointment, in order to bring us to the right place. Most Bible historians and scholars believe Moses had a large role in writing the book of Exodus. Some historians and scholars even believe that Moses may have compiled and wrote some of it, if not all, of Genesis before God calls him to go back to Egypt and deliver his people. So when God says, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, that Moses knew exactly who he was speaking to. And that is why Moses hid his face. Verse 7 says, and the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Verse 9. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. So God prepares Moses for 40 years. And after God beckons and draws him to him, he now calls Moses to a task, to a job, to his role in life. He tells Moses, remember all of your relatives that were in Egypt? Remember all of them? I've heard their cries for deliverance from Egypt, and I'm going to bring them away from this oppression into a land, a new land, a larger land with milk and honey flowing. And you, Moses, you are the man who will lead them out. Verse 11. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? Moses says, God, I don't know who you're talking to. I mean, I don't know what you see. I'm a nobody. Why in the world would you want to use me to do this? Moses was questioning God's choice of leadership. I think there's 3 reasons that he was. Number 1, because he felt inadequate about being the man for the job. Oftentimes when we're presented with something big, immediately, immediately we start thinking of our weaknesses and our downfalls and all the things that have happened in the past. And we say, I don't know how you would want me to do this. This is exactly what Moses was doing. It's very possible now, that, as some have said, that Moses had a speech impediment. He may have had a stuttering problem. You never know. But in my opinion, I think it could be a different reason. Moses had lived in Midian for 40 years. And it's very possible that he hadn't spoke the Egyptian language the whole time he was in Midian. So trying to go before Pharaoh, telling him that Yahweh wants to give his people a new zip code, might not come out quite right in broken Egyptian language. So he's kind of saying, God, are you sure you want me? Because I don't even remember half the vocabulary. But one of the second reasons, I think Moses may never felt truly accepted by his people. Every Egyptian knew Moses wasn't one of them. And every Jew knew he was one of them, but he didn't have to go through what they went through. Like, he lived in the palaces. He went to school. He had the best clothes. He ate the best food. Like, he may have been a Jew, but he wasn't going through the day in, day out torture like they were. He wasn't accepted by them. Instead, he was despised by them. He's saying, God, why do you want me to go get these people who don't even like me? Like, you want me to lead. You understand, they probably won't follow. You're not going to follow somebody that you don't like. So I think that's another reason why Moses was questioning God's calling of him being a leader. But lastly, I think this may be one of the biggest reasons. Moses was probably thinking in the back of his mind, you know, I wonder if my picture is still up on those wanted posters. Because this is very likely the same Pharaoh who was wanting to kill Moses 40 years earlier for murder. And Moses is thinking, you know what? You're calling me to stand in front of the guy who already wants to kill me and tell him that we're taking every single one of his slaves and we're leaving. He already hates me. I don't know if you can hate somebody any more than what he's going to, but I'm sure if you can, he's going to. Moses was scared. Moses was in bondage to his fear. Think about this. Don't miss this. God was calling a man to lead his people out of bondage who was in bondage to his fear and his inadequacy. God called a man in bondage to fear and inadequacy to lead people who were in bondage. How else are you going to get past your fear? The only way is by handing it over to God, trusting him, and facing it with his power and his strength. So God calls a man already in internal bondage to lead his people out of external bondage. But God also calls this man to lead his people out of Egypt into the desert. Now, who had been leading sheep around in the desert for 40 years? All right, this is the only time that you can look at it and say, if Moses is in a job interview, then he is highly, highly qualified for this job. Because ain't nobody out there knew that desert like Moses did. So God gives Moses some peace. As Moses is probably thinking through these things in his mind, he's trying to give him some peace. Moses thinks, you know what? If I can lead these dumb, directionless sheep around in the desert, surely human beings are a whole lot easier, right? Well, little would he know how many similarities that those people that he was about to lead out of Egypt have with those sheep that he led around for 40 years. Again, God gives Moses some peace in verse 12. So he, Yahweh, said, I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Moses, when you lead them out, you're going to know that I'm with you because I'm going to meet you back in this exact place. Trust me. Verse 13, then Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am, has sent me to you. Now here is the ultimate mic drop. Moses asked God, when I go to them and tell them you sent me, who do I say you are? Now, for a long time, even until just this last week, I thought that Moses asked this question because he didn't know who God was. But if Moses had been learning from his father-in-law Jethro, who was high priest to Yahweh, and he'd been learning all of these things, then he knew exactly who he was speaking to. I think this comes back to something a little bit different. When Moses asked that question, who do I say sent me? I think it goes back to Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God. Now stay with me for a second. Israel has been in Egypt for centuries. Egypt doesn't worship Yahweh. They don't worship God. They worship gods. So they have a God for everything. They have a God for nature. They have a God for weather. They have animals as gods. They have gods everywhere. Israel has grown accustomed to the Egyptian religion. And so it's quite possible and probable that there were Hebrews who were worshiping gods along with Yahweh. So we've learned this in our Wednesday night Bible study, The Bible for Grownups. It's going through how the Bible was comprised, and recently we just went through Genesis. And this was interesting to me. If Moses did indeed write Genesis, and I believe that he did write the comprised events that were given to him, then Moses is saying something what every other ancient religion is in stark contrast to. That God, Yahweh, singular, created everything and not gods. So, in the beginning, God, not gods. So when Moses says, who do I say sent me? He's not asking because he doesn't know. I believe he's asking because he doesn't know that Israel knows who he is. He's been away for 40 years. And if they have started worshiping other gods, maybe they don't really know who he is anymore. But God, with that mic drop, the ultimate mic drop, says, oh, they're going to know who I am. When you go to them and you say, I am that I am, which in other words means I am who is present, the one who has always been here, you tell them, I sent you. They'll know exactly who I am. Yahweh goes on to say in verse 15, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial to all generations. Go and gather the elders of Israel together and say to them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, appeared to me saying, I have surely visited you and seen what is done to you in Egypt. And I have said, I will bring you up out of the affliction of Egypt to the land of the Canaanites and to the Hittites and to the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Now get this. This is easy to lose in this translation. God said, tell them I'm going to lead them out of Egypt. And if they say, where? I'm not leading them out into the middle of nowhere. People know where these tribes dwell. So when they ask where, you can tell them God has a specific place that he's going to take us. It's not just going to be someplace wherever. No. It's going to be a good land. And it's going to be this specific land that he picked out for us. So Verse 21, and I will give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, and it shall be when you go that you shall not go empty-handed. Don't miss this. But every woman shall ask of her neighbor, namely of her who dwells near her house, articles of silver, articles of gold, and clothing. And you shall put them on your sons and on your daughters, so you shall plunder the Egyptians. God says, okay. And this is where all these infomercials get this. God says, I'm going to tell them I'm going to take them out of Egypt away from the bondage to a specific land. And there's more. When you leave, you're going to take all the riches of Egypt with you. Like, you're going to get all their gold, all their silver, all their clothes, all their jewelry. You're taking everything. And Moses, I know it sounds hard to believe, but when you do, they're going to be happy to watch you leave. When they leave Egypt, the Egyptians will rejoice when you leave by the time I'm done with them. So God calls Moses after a long preparation to lead his people out of bondage by giving him peace to free himself of his own bonds, and then tells Moses the game plan and outcome before the ball is even tipped. Not today. There may be some here on Facebook Live, and you're living with some kind of bondage, and I don't know what it is. Maybe it's fear. Maybe it's insecurity. Maybe it's your past. But the I am who I am wants to break your bonds today. Won't you do what Moses did and allow him to free you? Maybe there's somebody today who they're in bondage to a particular addiction or sin, or even you're abused mentally, physically, emotionally, psychologically. You don't have to live in that bondage. Paul tells us in Romans 6, verse 16, do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one's slave whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness? But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine, which that form of doctrine is salvation by grace through faith, to which you were delivered. And having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. Paul is saying, once you've been saved, you aren't in bondage to sin anymore. Jesus broke that. The Holy Spirit gives you power so that you don't have to sin. You don't have to live in addiction. You have the power to overcome all of that through self-control and the power of the Holy Spirit. Last thing. One of my favorite songs is by a group called Mercy Me. And the name of the song is entitled Undone. It says, no apologies for who I'm meant to be. The only thing that matters is I am free. When I am overwhelmed holding pieces of my heart, when I feel my world start to fall apart, to the cross I run, holding high my chains undone. Now I'm finally free, free to be what I've become, undone. Even in defeat, the face of tragedy, still you have to say that I found victory. In brokenness comes beauty, divine fragility, reminding me of nail-scarred hands reaching out for me. To the cross I run, holding high my chains undone. Now I am finally free, free to be what I've become, undone. Today, I don't know what you're struggling with or what you're in bondage to, but God is begging you to let him give you the power to break those bonds and free yourself to be what he wants you to become, undone. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for this time to look at your word. And God, we thank you for the story of Moses and the fact that you took a man, a murderer, who was running. And God, in his sin, you led him to the right place. And God, you forgave him, you used him, you blessed him. And that later on, you called him to do something great. And God, even in the midst of that, you called a man who lived in bondage to fear, to bring others in bondage out. And God, I pray today if there's someone out there who's listening, who's in bondage to a sin, to an addiction, anything, that God, you will let them know they have the power to overcome that. God, I pray that you will work in us, work through us. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, as the music begins to play, we don't do this normally, but I think this is a time. Maybe there's someone out there who's struggling with some sort of bondage, and you are tired of dealing with it. You're tired of holding on to it. You're tired of it holding you back. Maybe today you need to come down and just leave those bonds at the altar and ask God to help you leave them and walk away. So as the music begins to play, if you feel the need to come down, then please do.
Please stand, hymn 593.
Sin, my hand will sing.
get that a couple Sundays coming up that we will not be meeting together for United Sunday. I'm not sure if you all read that or not, but we will not be getting together for United Sunday as a group. If you would keep the kids and teachers in your prayers as school starts back up, just pray that everything goes smoothly and that there's kids don't come down with anything or teachers or anybody else. So just remember those if you would. I'll dismiss us in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for being merciful and gracious. God, I just pray this week, Lord, if there's something that you're working on us about, God, something that we're in bondage to, something that we need to get rid of so that you can use us better, that God, we will have the strength to do that and understand that you will give us the power to overcome it and to move forward. God, we thank you for loving us in Jesus' name. Amen.